How have you pursued purpose over notoriety? In a culture that is comment-driven rather than conversation-driven, what if we actually modeled having a conversation, different backgrounds, different perspectives around faith, life, and culture, and find this commonplace? Hey, what's up? I'm Torrin Wells, and this is Faith, Life, and Culture. These conversations revolve around this album, Citizen of Heaven. As we started writing some of these songs, I started thinking, maybe these songs are just one layer to a deeper conversation. So when I had the thought of putting together a faith, life, and culture conversation, I thought, let me put together a dream list of people.
Well, I'm Tim Tebow, and when Torrin called and asked me if I could be part of this, I said yes, because I think it's important when we actually do come together and have a relationship, because the church isn't a building we go to, it's a people that we do life with. And also, I love what Torrin does. I love what he stands for. I love his heart. To be able to support him means a lot to me.
I think people see Tim in this golden boy light, but he has been through some serious setbacks in his life. He just keeps getting back up to just keep coming at life.
My name is Rich Wilkerson Jr., and I pastor a church called VU Church in Miami, Florida. I think that we live in a world right now that everyone wants to be black and white. I think he has a really, really unique way of bringing both the sacred and the secular together. I found a whole lot of inspiration in it.
I wanted to have someone who has with integrity carried their faith into pop culture. He's great friends with Justin Bieber and Kim and Kanye. Rich is one of the leading voices in celebrity culture today.
My name is Tori Kelly. I'm a singer-songwriter, musician.
One of the most brilliant singers that I think I've ever heard. She's held on to who she is in the midst of an industry that wants to tell you who you need to be.
My faith has always been something super important to me. So when I heard, you know, there's going to be a bunch of people sort of in all different walks of life, all different sorts of platforms, it just kind of excited me.
Travis Greene brings energy and life into every room he walks into.
I love people who are the same off stage as they are on stage. And he's one of those people. He's a friend of everyone.
He has planted a church and yet tours and makes music. He's such a creative.
Hey, I'm Annie F. Downs, and I am here today because Torrin is just so good at making art that changes me. This feels like a real honor to be here.
A communicator, author, she has a podcast, being a real thought leader, how we wrestle through some of the tough questions of our faith.
When Torrin called me, I thought, man, they're asking me to speak into this?
Social Club Misfits, Marty and Fern.
Anything for friends, anything for our family, Torrin to be family.
Fern was released from prison. Marty was released from religion.
To sit down with these other people of same faith and same beliefs, but we see things through different lenses. How could I pass on it?
It's either this or playing video games at my house.
John Crist has made his platform poking fun at some of Christian culture. Comedians are very deep people who are using humor to process things that they're wrestling with.
All of us are coming from different perspectives, authors and athletes and comedians and pastors and musicians. Even within our faith, there's so many different nuances of opinions and thoughts. I feel like for all of us to come together, we can all benefit from each other.
How have you pursued purpose over notoriety?
You know, it's borrowed influence. And God just shares it with us for a little bit, and he can take it. Just like any gifts or talents he gives to us, the question is, while we have it, when we have it, do we use it, and what do we use it for? We could, like you were talking about, you could use it for fame, you could use it for family. I could use it for faith, I could use it for Jesus, and when I have those chances, am I going to stand for something? Right? And we don't all, you don't always have those chances.
Yeah.
There's only a handful of chances in your life where you really have to truly make a mark. And when you get those opportunities, are you going to be willing to say, you know what, it's more important for me to stand for Jesus than it is to stand for these other things? Yeah. And I think that was really good. And what you were saying just a minute ago about the inspiration and the motivation, and when we're trying to come up with things, and the way that God's used that in my life, He's used people or moments with people to inspire me. And that started when I was first wanting to share, wanting to help people. But I'm like, Dad, how do I actually share the gospel with someone? I don't know what to do. Like, and then the first time I got to speak to a lady on a park bench, and it was the first person that I ever led to the Lord. Wow. And it was just like so cool, you know? You're like, dang, God can use me, you know? And then I was like, you know, but like, God, I want to do more for you, you know? I want to do more. And I was like, Dad, I don't know what to do. And I can't share with all these like older people. And he's like, did you accept Jesus in your heart? Yes, I did. Then you have something to tell them. Because they have something that, they need something that you have. So you got something to tell them. That means you're qualified. That means you're equipped. It's just so easy in life to get caught up in things that just don't matter. You know, money, fame, and power. But it really, when we break it down, it really is pretty simple. It is about Jesus and it is about people, and we can't lose sight of that.
Good.
You know, and when we fall in love with Jesus, I believe we're going to fall in love with people.
Right. Yeah. Right.
And it doesn't mean that we're going to fall in like with people. We're going to fall in love with people, right, because we're going to value people because God puts value on people. Yeah. And, you know, if we really wanted to talk about creating change in our world, it starts with believers valuing people.
Yeah.
All people. Good. Different color, different background, different race, even different faith.
Yeah.
Even though they believe something different, I still value them because they were created in the image of God. They're created in love, by love, and for love. Yeah. Jesus still died for them. So instead of looking at them as less than, as insignificant, as different, I look at them as loved, as someone that God died for, as someone that I should love because God loved them.
Yep.
And so that when we value people, everything would change.
Yes.
That's great.
I knew that Tim was bold in his faith, but his boldness was inspiring. It called something out of everyone in the room. You could tell that what he was saying was coming from a genuine place of love and care for people. I got like a dream feature here with Kirk Franklin.
Woo!
Okay. Have you worked with Kirk? Just kidding.
It's called, I got so excited about this song. Yeah, it's so good.
Yeah. Okay, like this line, if I had a dollar for every time they said God wasn't going to come through, I'd be a millionaire. Ooh. What? Like swaggy
so
faith.
Good.
That's
like
that's that. The next part of Mike's.
Give that to Mike.
If I had a dollar for every time they say God wasn't going to come through, I'd be a millionaire. If I had a dollar for every time they say God wasn't gonna come through, I'd be a millionaire.
Oh, so catchy.
I love it.
So catchy.
I love you. You just interject like little phrases.
But God's came pumping right on time.
You know, like perfect
you
timing.
Way out my way. Yeah. And I thought it was the end, but He stepped in again and made a way. Time they say God wanna gonna come through.
Neither one of us are from
the restaurant.
Yeah, Kurt.
If I had a dollar for every time they say God wanna gonna come through, I'd be a millionaire. Oh,
okay, when was a time like you thought God was going to answer prayer a certain way and it totally didn't happen, but then what actually happened blew your mind?
Oh, snap. I remember one time I was locked up. For those who don't know, I did some time. And I remember talking to my classification officer. You get like a guidance counselor in prison. You get a classification officer. And she's basically letting me know what I need to do to go to work early. She's like, here's what I got. I think you need to go to this drug program and we can get you there earlier and, you know, kind of get your custody dropped down and get you in the work release process faster. I'm like, whatever, man, I'm locked up. Let's do what you want to do, whatever you want to do. So I'm hearing about this. I'm hearing rumors on the pound. Yeah, you're going to go to Bridges of Pompano. Mind you, I live in Broward County. So I'm like, yo, that's right by my house. I'll see my family. That's going to be great.
Yeah.
So I remember it came time, you know, the time was coming. I knew the time was coming and, you know, I was going to find out whether this was going to happen or not. I had to go to see my classification officer and she told me, listen, you got approved.
Wow.
And I'm like, in my head, I'm going to Bridges. I'm going to go furloughs with my wife, with my family. I'm going home.
Yeah.
But you're going to Orlando. So it was kind of a little, you know, melancholy because we were talking like, look, I'm going to Orlando and I really didn't know what to expect.
How far away are those two places?
So I'm in Miami. So it's about 2.5, 3 hours maybe difference now.
Yeah.
So I went from having
visits. Not your family's neighborhood.
At all. I went from having visitations every week to once a month, you know, so. But little did I know that God was all in it.
Yeah.
So, because look, I and I'll end it with this. Like, I wound up going to Pompano, you know, for my work release, but for that drug program, which I thought, oh, I need to go to Pompano now. No, the Lord said, you're going to come up here to Orlando and I'm going to cover you.
Good.
And I'm going to hide you for a minute in my faithfulness. You just hold down. Just stay down till I bring you up.
Yeah.
So I know this sounds crazy. When I got to Pompano, which I thought was what I wanted, it was hell there.
Yeah.
It was a zoo. It was crazy. Sometimes, like, when the power wasn't on, we're taking showers with hoses and things of that nature. These are things that really try to break us down.
Yeah.
You know, they really try to break us down. But the Lord spared me for that year, and he kept me, and he kept me happy, and he kept me ready. He kind of, like, get me ready for that final phase. He's, like, final level. He got me rested up and ready for that final level. But it was what I thought I wanted, what I thought was the right deal, what I thought, oh, I'm going to go home and visit with people. It wasn't time for that. We always think we know what's right. We oh my God, especially when we know how to navigate our own lives. But you know what? At the end of the day, me going through that and doing it the way that it ended up, it's like, God, man, you was there
God's
the whole
provision
time.
Was in it.
He was there the whole time.
Yeah. Fern talked about his time in prison, the reality of what was his life a few years ago. It showed the diversity of life experiences that we had in the room, but also the power of the gospel, even to those that we think are so far out. To me, it just spoke of God's goodness and God's grace. All right, this song is called Perfect Peace.
Oh, I like this one.
Remind me again who you are. I struggle to take a breath. Tell me I'm safe in your arms. You're seated upon a throne. The universe at your command. Show me that I'm not alone. No, I'm not alone. Though I'm tossed by the wind and crashing waves.
So good, bud.
Crashing waves. With one word on my face start to fade away. You're over it all. Though I'm tossed by the wind and the crashing waves, with one word on my face start to fade away.
That nice fade out. Oh, come on now.
Okay.
That's
it right there.
Yeah.
You wrote the entire every single
with collaborators, with co-writers and producers.
That
was an idea that I had. I just had that melody and that line, that perfect piece. I was actually speaking about prayer, and I saw this scripture that peace stands guard at our hearts. And I thought, like, you keep me in perfect peace. If we allow the Prince of Peace to be the Lord of our life, then any fear has to get through him to get to me.
Beautiful.
And so it's so important in this generation the millennials have been called the anxious generation.
Oh, wow.
There was an article in Time magazine that called the age we're living in the age of fear. And I don't know if it's use these words more flippantly, like, yeah, this gives me anxiety. Like the Chick-fil-A drive-thru line gives me anxiety. Rich, you did a message recently called Anytime Anxiety Comes, right? I wanted you as a voice really loud and clear among millennials. What messages are you communicating about fear, worry, and anxiety?
He's like, oh, think about my points. One, two,
three. Yeah, yeah, yeah. What was that
message? How long ago was that?
No, I just think, I think the song, first and foremost, is it's beautiful, but it's so relevant. Like, it's so pertinent. And I'd live a whole lot of life with millennials and in Generation Z, and I would say, regardless of what the facts tell us, I'm with people. And I think that there is a lot of things that are happening right now that are alarming when it comes to depression, anxiety, and fear. I read a stat the other day that the number one killer right now for people 15 to ages of 25 is suicide.
Yeah.
I mean, like, what are we talking about? Like, so I think that there's so many things I think that are contributing right now to an anxious world. I think it begins with this freaking phone that we all carry in our pockets that every time we take a break, we're all checking it, including myself, that we're addicted to it. And I think the nonstop, like, everyone we kind of who's walked in today, it's like, oh man, like, how you doing? It's like, busy. You know, like Tim might be like, oh man, we're busy. It's like, that's kind of like the natural like response that everyone's just busy.
Yeah.
And there's principles in God's word that like is so, like the idea of Sabbath, which doesn't get talked about a lot, you know, like there's 9 commandments we all believe in. We're all still wondering about one of them, which is remember the Sabbath, you know, like, I don't know how we interpret that, but Sabbath really means to stop. I mean, Shabbat, to stop, to cease. It's not a day off. It's a stopping and a trusting of God. And I struggle in that a whole lot. And I did a message recently called Anytime Anxiety Comes, and it was a message on prayer. And it was from that same verse you read, Philippians 4. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And then the peace of God, here's the key word, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts. And here's the best word, and your minds.
Right.
Yeah. And what it tells us is that we serve a God who cares about our soul, but he cares about our mental health as well.
Yeah.
And this peace is peace that is offered to us in the midst of all the chaos, in the midst of all the fast pace that we're living in. And this peace, for the good news for all of us, it transcends understanding, meaning when you have pain that doesn't make sense, he's promising us a peace that doesn't make sense. But there are some things in there that we don't always apply. I don't know. A lot of people like, prayer's cliche. A lot of people that say that, they actually don't pray. You know?
I learned that.
It's like, I don't know, man. You've got to try. You got to put some of this stuff into application. But
it's so good and it's so encouraging. And another thing that's so encouraging to me about that is it's looking at where the writer was when he was writing Philippians. So he's saying, be anxious for nothing, but he's in the bottom of a jail cell, which a lot of scholars believe that he was in sewage up to his waist because all the sewage was been on the bottom floor. He's on the bottom chained up. When you picture it, right, you're like, okay, perspective is so important in this world. We just lose it so fast. I know I lose it, and I think a lot of people lose it. Oh my gosh, I'm dealing with persecution. No, go overseas. Let me take you to some places where we're real persecution. Let me take you to all the places where we've literally picked up kids that are thrown in the garbage or in wells. You know, let's take you to real persecution. Not saying that people, what they're going through is not easy, but it's just it's so important to keep perspective.
There's no doubt
on what really matters.
All of us can agree there's an epidemic on our hands right now.
Absolutely.
And I think that perspective is vital. But in the same token, it's like even us, we have to get better as artists, as creators, as content deliverers, as ministers of the gospel to figure out practical handles for people because people are losing their lives left and right. And I can go through stories back home that we're dealing with. And I would just say, and I would love to, because everyone here is quote unquote, hear me, like successful at what they do. Most people would be shocked to go, wow, Travis, you deal with anxiety sometimes. Why, man? Like, I've dealt with it, and I want to be careful with the words too, because I think it is thrown around flippantly. Yeah. But I wrote the message because it's kind of what you're saying, where it's like I think I'm talking to people, and people are feeling this way. And for me, I'm always trying to come back to like root causes of the fruit in your life. And I think a big thing is just this whole space that we live in of comparison. That like I didn't know how unhappy I was until I
saw how happy you are, you know? Yeah, like, yeah. I was cool with my whatever, and then, yeah. Oh, that's what you got?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
And I think it's crushing and killing our contentment on a major level, and I think it takes influencers, sorry for all these, you know, these like culturally relevant words, but if we don't speak about it and deconstruct it, my life is, Instagram is a portion of my life, and it's usually just the good parts of my life. Like, I got a bunch of other stuff going on, and I think people end up comparing their low moment to like whatever they think my high moment is. And it's like, no, we got to do a better job, I think, at telling the story.
But don't you think a big part of that is we're putting matter into things that don't matter as much as we think they do?
Certainly.
You know, we're putting matter in, okay, I'm going to think about committing suicide because I was bullied at school because they don't like me. That's a real problem. It's a real issue. But they don't get to define you. And we could, when we can share with that young person that even though they might not like you at school, those people don't get the right to define you.
Absolutely.
And we're putting so much worth in being liked and what people say on social media. And, you know, I get to, I'm going to talk to a team later today where one of the members of their team died this year from that. And it's real, but it's so real too because they think that when John likes me, that's my life.
Yeah. There's an absence of truth in it.
That's right.
Like there is the reality of our lives, but it's absent of the real truth about life, that those voices don't define you. But I also think a lot of times it's the pace of our lives.
Yeah. Right, because that mom that's sitting in Chick-fil-A who says, I'm anxious about this line, she does actually feel that. Yeah. But it's not about Chick-fil-A.
Yeah.
It's not about the line. It's that there's somewhere else she's supposed to be. I mean, it is all the stuff. It's what you said. It's the root stuff.
But somewhere else she's trying to be because she's made it up in her mind that she has to be important or present or at something.
Or something's wrong. Or so I think that's really true when she says, I feel anxious about this. I bet she does. Yeah. But it has nothing to do with the nuggets.
Yes.
It has everything to do with everything else.
Everything else.
Yeah.
And everything that's happening.
And getting that perspective
internally. Like Tim was saying. You know, I think what I want to hear from you guys is how do you handle it? Because I know that there are different degrees to this, okay? I'm not talking about I had a panic attack. You know, that is real for some people. But even in your song, Two Places, you're talking about sometimes I'm in this headspace, but also emotionally I'm somewhere else. Mm-hmm. I'm sitting on the couch next to my son, but I'm thinking about the tour. And I think that that feeds into this tension that we feel.
Yeah.
You're running through the airport, John, and you're like, do you feel like I got to make a video? And then, because we're saying that stuff doesn't matter, but if I just stop singing, then I shut down all of my busy problems.
Yeah.
But then I can't feed my family. So how do you guys deal with the
And you're not being a good steward of what God gave you.
As a guy that's like, I think I started creating art in a lot of ways. God gave me a gift, but in a lot of ways, I'll be honest, I'm insecure. I like when people are looking at me and talking about me, if I was being totally honest.
I'll raise my hand on that too.
So there's times when you have a premise of an idea of like, this is funny, but it also could value, it could contribute to the worth of the community of the body. And then there's other times where like I would like to post a story because I want my notifications to blow up because I know that I'm going home tonight and I'm going to be by myself.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
Yep.
That's it.
So like what is to be said to that? We're like all the things that come through this phone that have been the cause of all of my anxiety and depression, also I could choose to leave at any time.
Yep.
And I could go work at Staples or what? No disrespect to anyone who works at Staples.
Yes.
You could leave it, but it causes you so many problems, but I keep almost like going back to this thing that is like honestly given me some level of like love and acceptance and worth since I was 12. Mm-hmm. I would like to put it down, but it's like you have a message that you want to contribute to your book. Also, 3 weeks later, you want to sneak onto the bestseller list and see how it's doing.
Yeah.
Right. There's no doubt.
And it's like,
Isn't it okay to try to want both if you balance it the right way, though? You know?
Yeah.
But I think that's the problem that we're having right now is discovering the balance. I think the starting point is what you're doing, which is the honesty, the vulnerability of where we're actually all at.
Something that John Crist mentioned was his real battle with being successful, but also feeling like you have to go back to empty things. That is a tension. You don't succeed your way out of that. You never get enough accolades. You never get enough awards. We are constantly driven to do more and more, and yet we try to go back to empty things. We never tied a bow around that, and I'm okay with that.
What I get concerned about, and I've helped create this culture. You know what I mean? Like, so I'm more kind of trying to look at myself and go, man, am I just showing and projecting a pace that few could probably even run at?
Yes.
And maybe I'm graced for it. I mean, that's a whole other, but it's like, I think there's got to be some leaders, there's got to be some influencers who actually debunk the myth and the fact that this is false, you know, that this thing, if you keep eating from, you know, I like, if you turn the Apple phone off, you know, the iPhone, last thing you see is like a bitten apple, you know, it's almost like they're like, yo, just reminding you, if you keep eating from this tree, this ain't gonna satisfy you, bro. Like, it's like, Steve Jobs is still preaching to us, but it's like, I think there's more to it, but yeah, I think you're right. I think we have to help people. This is what leadership is about. It's like trying to, how do you balance that? Because what you're saying, you are called to put out an album. I think you're called to go on tour. Yeah, you're going to be judged one day. That's a whole other thing we could talk about right now. There's a second judgment about what did you do with what I told you to do.
Right. Yeah,
and I am called to multiply. And the only way I'll multiply is if I maximize what God's given me. But there is this balance, and I think there's principles in God's word. Yeah. Things like the Sabbath I don't do it right. You know what I mean? Like. Yeah. Hey, God, I'm going to trust you with 6 days rather than trust myself with seven.
For sure.
Hey, God, I'm going to trust you with 90% of my money rather than trust myself with 100%. There's these things that I'm going, that these are just basic gauges that I think help do the balancing act that we're trying to do.
I'll just throw out one thing. My wife said this past Sunday because we're kind of on this page, and I was preaching real good. I was talking about how you got to be in the will of God.
Send me the message. I need some for Sunday,
bro. It wasn't even a sermon. I'm just up on stage flowing. I end up not preaching because it's going crazy. My wife was like, great. She's like, that's good. She's like, she was on stage with me, and she was like, can I say something? I was like, sure. And she said something that was so much better than anything that I was saying. She was like, I want to say something because if you take what we're telling you up here, you're going to be disappointed when you follow God on the first instruction, but don't come back to him to find out the how to. She said, a lot of times we get hyped and it's like, God told me to quit my job. I'm going to do it. And now you're mad at the pastors and you're mad at God because you're like, well, you told me to have faith, but I don't know what to do. Something so amazing happened with Abraham. God tells him, and he told him this multiple times, but when he first calls Abraham, he says, yo, Abraham, go, I'm gonna show you a land. I think the beauty in that is Abraham starts walking, but he has to keep his ear open. Mm-hmm. He says, I'm gonna show you. Even in Genesis, when he tells him to sacrifice his son, he says, go, I'm gonna show you what mountain. Mm-hmm. When you get there, I'll tell you what to do. When you get on top of the mountain, I'll give you instruction there. And it's like that call to constantly have your ear open. I think where anxiety enters our life, because most of us are living in the dream. We're literally inside of our prayer request. Like we're waking up to moments that we begged God 4 years ago. Yeah. It's like, God, if you just trust me with this. Wow. And now we're in here and it's like, there's some misery in here. Yeah. Like, where did this come from? Yeah. And it's because we gave him the first yes. Your marriage will fall if your only I do is on the day of the wedding.
Hello.
And so many times we get in these moments, it's like, it's beautiful. This feels good.
Was he looking at me with the marriage?
He's gonna send you a bill later on for marriage counseling.
But you gotta keep coming back. And I love what you said, and I'm done, but it's practical. It's prayer. Like, you don't graduate from it. You don't graduate really from good. A life of prayer, of fasting, of studying. Right. Like, give me this day my daily bread. Like, great, you gave me that word 5 years ago, and I'm in the manifestation of that. But how do I manage this today? Yeah. Am I doing too much today? Am I going too fast today? And if I don't have that instruction, I'm short.
And Toro, I think when we keep saying prayer, it's like there's all these facets to prayer in even the Bible. Not prayer is just processing and talking with God, of course, but like, be still and know that I am God.
Yeah.
Some of us, we're so busy, we never take time to be still, and we never know he's God. And so I've stepped into meditation this past year. I've stepped into 2-minute reflections and pausing and stillness because in the busyness and the pace and the chaos, I've got to find some moments to come back to, okay, here I am, count my breaths and fill my mind with what God says about me, which is where I get my value. But I just think things like stillness and things like being quiet for a moment. You don't have to, I go to this because I'm afraid to be alone. I'm afraid to be, and that's what you're saying. It's like,
you want
to
feel busy.
Yeah, let me feel like I'm accomplishing something. I'm here right now. Am I supposed to be there?
And our thoughts are scary, I think.
But stillness makes you confront who you are and who God is. And that's where you discover your value and your worth.
Tori, talk about that with your thoughts. Like you said, sometimes your thoughts are scary.
Yeah. Mine, I don't know about y'all, but mine are for sure sometimes. I think what you were saying, Rich, is so great because I think, like in, you mentioned my song, Two Places, and that's really what that song is about, is just like, I have this, even like conflicting emotions, like sometimes I'll have, you know, I'll be really happy and sad at the same time. It sounds kind of crazy, but it's, you know, I've ran into people, you know, at my shows or whatever, they really connect with that song. I'm like, okay, I'm not alone in that. And I think it has to do with everything we're saying, you know, this social media culture and just all these things competing for attention. And it's like, when I do have those moments where I'm like, oh yeah, you know, be still and know that I'm God, it's like this new concept for me where I'm like, wait, I've always known this. Like, why do I forget that that is so crucial to just have even just a couple minutes, like you said, but you know, ideally, like a whole day or something where you're just like phone off. And maybe that's one of the more practical things if we're talking about like a day-to-day thing. I think it first starts with, again, your identity. That's where it has to begin, because knowing that all of this can fall apart and go away and I would still have Christ, that's the first thing. You know what I mean? So it's like, okay, I know that. Got to remind myself of that every day. Got to remind myself of who he is and who he says that I am. And then we can start to go, okay, now practical things. Maybe, you know, on this day every week I you know, ditch my phone or something. Yeah, or maybe I just post something on Instagram, but I don't scroll for another hour after that. You know what I mean?
Post like, and delete.
Post off.
Delete like, the app. Deleting soon.
Because I think, too, like, I don't want to paint a picture that, like, I don't want us to paint a picture either that social media and the internet is bad either. Because I think it's about finding that balance, finding, you know, what are the good things about it. Because, you know, we have to be moving towards where the culture is going
how
as well.
You use
and
it.
Like, yeah, exactly how you use it. So
observing Tori Kelly today, she was so engaged in the conversation. I started to think about how difficult it must be to, in many rooms that you're in, be the only person of faith. And so to sit around a circle with people speaking authentically was really special. And maybe what we kind of all felt, this conversation was enriching. Do you think we have, as the church, the wrong messaging around emotions?
There's a couple of things that are really interesting about our age bracket. Number one, we're the first Christian leaders to lead online ever. And so no one has taught us how to do this.
Wow.
So when you say you helped create the culture of what we're doing, well, of course you did, Rich, because our parents didn't have the internet. And of course we're doing that. Of course John's videos are doing that. So we have to go to the Lord and go lead us into this land we've never lived in before. And the exact same is true about how we talk about our mental health and emotions is that I'm not sure generations before us were as willing to say, I'm a leader and I'm in therapy. I'm a leader and everything Jesus says about himself is true and I believe it. And also I have problems that I don't know how to handle alone. So I've gone to on-site or I've gone to counseling or and so it feels, and y'all can fix me if I'm wrong on this, it feels like we're getting better at it. Like I feel like it isn't quite the like, oh, she's in counseling? It's more like, yeah, I bet she is.
That's my response.
We need leaders to step up and say that.
Yes.
I remember Stephen Furtick saying that. He's like, I go to therapy. I go. You know, it's funny, like, just to kind of tag on what John was saying, like, this, just being completely transparent, Sunday, I had those deep, dark, I had a really low moment in my own personal life where it just, you know, sometimes that wave hits you. And it comes out of nowhere, and you're like, what the heck is happening? And I started, it was happened on Instagram, of all things. And so I'm looking on Instagram, and this deep sense of, like, loneliness hit me. And I just started praying. And I felt the Lord said to me, he's like, you know, you're looking at all these people and what they're doing. Like, what if I have you in the right spot? Mm-hmm. Like, what if you're where you're supposed to be? Mm-hmm. You know, like I'm looking at other people and being like, man, I kind of wish I was there or doing this or doing that. And even this year, we had some of the biggest offers given to us pulled out of, like the carpet was pulled. And we were like, wow, what are we doing this year? Like, what's God, what's happening? And so at VU conference, I remember we take our team to VU conference to just like reset. And I remember this year, like we had so much disappointment and it was awful. And I think the Holy Spirit was kind of like speaking to us. And he was like, last year you did like 250 dates. He's like, this year I need you to rest. I have to force you to rest.
Yeah.
I literally, I cancel everything.
Yeah.
So what if I had, God's saying this to me, mm-hmm. what if I have you where I need you to be? Why would you complain? And I felt this sense of like, I'm sorry, God, for thinking that. But at the same time, like security and knowing maybe I am where God wants me to be.
Yeah.
You know, like, why am I trying to fight it? Why am I trying
There's peace in knowing that.
Yeah. It's a peace in knowing like maybe dad's got it. Yeah. You know, like maybe everything is where it's supposed to be right now.
Yes.
And
it's that open door and closed door thing, right? Like, do we really believe a closed door is a good thing?
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
when those things get pulled out from under you, you go like,
we love God's
rejection.
Yes.
Oh, we love the yeses, but then says, the closed doors were like, stop. What's happening? And you're like, well, what if I took them all as gifts?
Yeah.
What if they were all a gift and they were all telling me something about what he has for me and what we're supposed to be doing here?
Yeah.
And you just get to live more grateful, I think.
I've been challenging this idea. I think you wrote about this in your book, Shaken. You talked about fear and feelings and faith. And I've been challenging this idea, and I've wanted to ask you about it because I feel like the language in church regarding emotions is basically my faith is a superpower that allows me to somehow fly above the pain of my real life.
Wow. Mm.
And so in services, we tell people, man, you gotta faith it till you make it.
That's right.
It's faith over feelings. But I've been challenged with this idea of, well, maybe it's my faith in my feelings. Because God built me with these emotions to lead me to his glory.
There's no doubt. I totally agree and believe. And one thing that it's kind of been on my heart lately is emotions versus convictions. Mm-hmm. And we have both. But which one do we feed? Which one do we listen to? And which one do we act upon? So for so much of my life, that was for sports. Like, I didn't want to get up early and train. Tired, I'm sore, I don't want to get up. My convictions say get up anyways.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't want to be nice to people. My convictions say do it anyways.
Yeah.
You know, I think it's important for us to understand that we have emotions, but emotions, they don't have to define us. They don't get to define us. Now they're real, and sometimes they're good, sometimes they're great, but sometimes they are so low. But the one thing that my sister teach me from being overseas and having so many things happen to her over there, and even having some of their ministry partners murdered for their faith.
Wow. Mm.
And she would remind me when I feel like I wanted to, you know, vent about what people are saying about me, she would say, I know you got pain and I know it hurts, but God will never waste your pain when it's given to him.
Amen.
Yeah.
Wow.
He'll never waste it.
So good.
And you know, it means a lot more coming from her, you know, and there's in that situation.
Yeah.
And it was just like, yeah. Man, I'm going through nothing. Like, it felt like it's a lot, but it's nothing.
Yeah.
You know, and then it's to understand God's promises, because one of the ways that the devil tricks us is that he diminishes those promises and we don't hold them. But if we really knew, like what you just said, I love what both of y'all just said, be still and know that I'm God. And you just said the same thing. But if we knew that if I stopped for 2 minutes, like you just said you do, I knew beyond a shadow of a doubt God was going to show up, I would be so excited about being still.
Right.
Yeah. Like, we just shut up for 2 minutes and we knew beyond a shadow of a doubt God's going to show up, we'd be like, dang, this is awesome. But he is.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's what we have to remind ourselves of, the promises of God. And I'm one of those people that, you know, I don't get it all the time. But I got to repeat His promises to me. I got to choose it over and over and over again. You know, in John 16:33, for in me you have peace, in the world you have tribulation. Take heart, I've overcome the world.
Yeah.
It says take heart. That's a choice we make. Right. We make the choice to take heart, to literally take heart, to take courage. I'm going to choose it because I'm going to tell myself God's promises over and over and over again. So when, you know what, when I do have those bad thoughts, when I do want to be bitter, when I do want to be pissed off, when I want to be irritated, when someone wronged me, when they really lie about me in articles, when it's really, you know, it's not the truth.
Right, yeah.
You know, I have the, my emotions say it's okay to be pissed off, but my convictions say, you know what, you need to understand I'm doing something in this. You don't know what it is, but trust my promises. Did I leave you now? Did I leave you? No, I didn't leave you. Are you still having an impact? Yeah, you're having an impact. You know, you got to remind yourself of God's promises. And then enough of reminding yourself of God's promises, then it helps you regain perspective and understanding. And it still doesn't mean that it doesn't hurt, because it still hurts.
Sure.
Right. Yeah.
And that's why I think it's so important to do what we're doing right now.
I think, Torin, where the church needs to grow and where we need to get better, and because everything he's saying is so important. And then, but the underlying factor there is that feelings essentially are coming from our thoughts.
Yeah.
And so what do you do when your mind is damaged? What do you do when your mind doesn't have the strength to, scripture says, don't be transformed to patterns of this world, you know, by the renewing of your mind.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so feelings come from thoughts. Emotions come from thoughts. Mm-hmm. That's why we're, you know, we can keep using Instagram, the things that we watch and see and keep thinking about creative feeling. You can watch a scary movie. It's not real. You feel scared. You can... And I think where we're learning as the church is we have to remove the stigma. Like, if you break your leg, we all go, yeah, put a cast on that, man. Get some crutches. Right. And everyone's like, okay, come around, Torin.
Yeah.
But if your mind is injured,
that's right.
We don't always have the same compassion. I think the church needs to have a deeper sensitivity, because I meet people that their heart is in the right place, that they desperately don't want to be anxious. They desperately want to come out of depression. And I'm gonna preach as loud as I can on Sunday. I'm gonna shout and sweat and lose my voice and look like a crazy man trying to get people to get inspired.
Yeah.
But sometimes, man, it's like sermons, they don't always change people. They're a catalyst for change, but we gotta help give some people some legs to get some other things.
And it's ultimately gonna be the Holy Spirit that, that changes the mind and the heart. But the one thing I don't want to leave out about what she said is when it's given to Him.
Yeah, surrender it to Him,
when we give it to Him.
It's beautiful.
Because a lot of times, we'll just keep the pain. Because sometimes, this is going to sound weird, but pain makes us feel good. Yep. We hold on to that pain, because when I hold on to the pain, I can hold it against you.
Yeah,
wow.
When I can hold on to the pain, it's a form of comfort in my resentment. Mm-hmm. But when I let go of the pain, I have nothing to hold on to.
Right. So I'm letting you
free. I can't hold on to it.
Yeah.
I let you, when I don't want to let you free, because you wronged me. If I let go of this pain, I'm really forgiving you, and I don't want that, because that's not comfortable for me.
Wow.
I think God does a whole lot when we do that in our life.
So good.
And when we say too, like, God, thank you for this pain. Thank you for this moment. Teach me something in it. I don't like it, but you can do something in me with it, through it. Like, you know, I just think that
it's the invitation to allow Him to. I love what Marty said. I mean, it's so powerful. The reality is, if I'm staring at my phone and I'm overwhelmed by the snare to compare and all this going on, but you still have to accept. You know, my wife says, I'm sorry, I can't help but quote her. She's brilliant.
Yeah, yeah.
But she says that prayer is an invitation from God. Like, He's inviting you to a place with Him. And you can choose, though, to I'll remain consumed by this. I'll accept His invitation to prayer.
So
to me, it's practical, but it's the only thing that's going to work. I mean, everything else is great, but I think everything else is an addition to the main thing. And the main thing is, bro, you're in trouble if you don't pray. And no one's above that. And I think it's more dangerous to us than anybody else, because we could justify everything. Everything that I do is justified by ministry. You understand? So my pace, my wifey, I can't be there. Oh, I really need these shoes. I really got to do this. I really need to go there.
And even the and releases, all, even the things you do
it's
in
all
secret,
for God.
It's just so hard.
Yeah, it's all for God.
Yeah.
It's all for God. But the question is not if it's for God. The question is if it's with God. And the only way it can remain with God is if He's telling me today, this is what I need to do, you know?
You could tell Travis Green and Rich Wilkerson Jr., pastor people. Being a pastor
You are in the trenches with people. If you notice throughout this conversation, when a big idea came out, they broke it down to everyday life. I need to rest. I need to shut my phone off. Some real things that help us control the pace of our minds and the pace of our lives. Because I think we're all figuring out, how do we take these big ideas that we hear about in scripture or are preached from a platform on Sunday and carry them into Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday? Some people accept the idea of God based on a feeling or an emotion. Some people need hard proof and facts to know that God is real. What category do you fall in, and when did you know for yourself, like, God is real, he's real to me, and I want him to have every part of my life?
If you look in the Old Testament, the children of Israel, God literally parted the water and they walked across, and as soon as they got across, they go, yeah, but maybe.
Right.
I don't know.
Even like, seeing the miracles.
You look, you're like, all right, if I walked across a box, surely I would be like, I'm in.
Yes.
And you look at whatever, like, if they're like, man, like, some, there was like this whole documentary on like finding Noah's Ark. Like, dude, but if we found it,
it proves
then.
Right.
We're like, yeah, but nah. Somebody's brought back to life. Then, but there's no instance in the Bible where it's a constant, it's a daily, for me, reminder of like, oh yeah, remember when you went to that thing, and then he was like, yeah, I got you, dude. Yes. Like, oh yeah.
One of my favorite verses is like, it's at the end when Jesus is like ascending to heaven. It's like he's died, he's resurrected from the grave, and it's like he's ascending, and the scripture says, many believed, but still some doubted.
Yeah, he's literally being taken away.
Like, what more do you need? I don't know.
I'm not sure.
I know.
I saw him put him in the thing, and then he was in there, and then the rock.
Body double, man. Chris Angel, man.
Just preach the text, Rich. Okay, yeah. Sorry.
I always picture myself, they're like, what if I was born in that time? Like, what would I do? Like, would I believe? But I don't know. I think to answer your question, I think it's a mixture of both, I think. Mm-hmm. Even when we're talking about prayer, it's like you can't know how to pray unless that's our model for prayer is the word of God. You know, it's like I think when we're talking about feelings, that feeling is, I think, can be the Holy Spirit as well. Like, I think he can like lead you into prayer. I mean, there's times where I literally just like sit and pray and I'm like, I don't know what to pray. Like, there's the verse that's like, he'll give you, like, he'll give you the words. And I think those have been some of my most powerful moments when I literally have nothing to pray for. And I'm just sitting there, I'm like, and then it just starts.
What do you want me to pray for?
Exactly. Yeah. And then things start coming to my mind and it's just like a flow.
Well, I think there's a humility in that, you know, which this whole idea around peace and rest and Sabbath, it really boils down to humility and trust. If I'm living at this active pace that I feel like my calling demands that I operate at, it's almost as if I think the success that bears is it, on bro. And from me.
That's it.
But if I can stop and be still, come home from work and shut the computer and be done for the day, and say, God, the results are truly in your hands. That is a place of trust, and it's a place of real humility.
That's saying a lot with an album coming out. Yeah. I mean, for you to really go like, okay, I'm going to live this in front of these people who just heard me say it, but in front of me by watching, like, I'm releasing an album, and I believe this is true.
Yeah.
And so that means we get to watch what your faith looks like.
Well, amazing things, and you could probably testify to this, the most amazing things that have happened to me, we'll say in career, were not things that I manufactured out of my own strength or gifting. Mm-hmm. Like, I didn't do anything to go on the Lionel Richie tour. Didn't go to a showcase, didn't audition, you know? Yeah. Now, there was a culmination of work that came along with it, but for that one opportunity to manifest, it was God saying, okay, time for this.
Yep.
You don't choose what video blows up.
Nah, I wish I could. If I would make those.
Pick them all.
The weird thing about that is the
people call it rehab. We didn't go to rehab. It was like a retreat type center place that we went, not together. We've been to this place.
We've both been to on-site.
Yeah, we've been to this place on-site.
I can fix that for you.
Yeah, I got that. Sounds better. But the one rule, why I was attracted to go there, is two rules. You can't have your phone, and B, you can't say what you do for a living.
Yeah, you can't have that conversation.
So you just pull up, like everywhere I go, even here, I'm valued as a comedian. Every time I see someone at the airport, oh, dude, comedian, I love the video of it. And then you just pull up to this place in the out in the woods, and you go, yo, my name's John.
Yeah.
And then, like, if you take a month off from all of this,
yeah,
you're just a dude taking out the trash and
changing poopy butts.
And you're like, I got nothing.
Right.
Right? So it's like this call back to this place that we all are valued in because of the skill set we have. But if you said, I'm done making music, if you said, I'm done preaching, if you said, I'm done writing, if you said, I'm done comedy, who's going to still be there? And that should be your crew, is what you were saying. You should skip one of the performances for a wedding because that's who you. Community. That's all you got.
Yeah. You know, it's funny because like, when I T.D. Jakes said this. He said we can always look at a moment in our life where we remember God showed up. Like they come and they kind of mark our life. Like, man, I remember being depressed, thinking I think it's time to commit suicide. I think planning it out. They always say when you plan it out, that's when it's really bad. And I remember thinking, going back then, but then little subtle reminders that God is, he's still with me. You know, I think about, like, they always say doubting Thomas. I even hate that, you know? Like, I even hate how sometimes when we read the Bible, it's like, the woman with the issue of blood, well, she was healed. So why are we still confining her to her issue, you know? But I think about, like, for me, I relate to doubting Thomas. I relate to Thomas, you know, like that whole story of him doubting. And like, he puts up these walls, but then Jesus walks through the walls.
Yeah,
you know, like for me in my own life, like through the darkest moments, I could say I remember God was there. And look, in retrospect, you see, wow, he was really there for me. Yeah. And little by little, there's my life is being marked by little moments that probably would not, if I tell somebody, they're gonna be like, wow, God came like at that moment. Yeah, maybe this odd moment that probably I couldn't even share at a church, but God reveals himself in those little moments, like even being backstage. And you know, you have a concert and it's you're excited. Everyone wants to see you there, but then God's like, hold on. I want a little bit of time.
It's that whole thing of, well, he wasn't in the, we see the prophet, he's in this place where his mental capacity is broken.
Yes.
And he's looking for God in the fire and he's not in the fire and he looks for him in the earthquake and he's not in the earthquake. And then God whispers to the prophet and this song, Close, is actually
my joint.
Yeah.
That was the one for me. Of God whispers because he's close.
But after the fire came a gentle whisper. And when Elijah heard it, when he got out of the cave, he heard the voice. And the voice said to him one more time, what are you doing here? I say, God, why did you whisper to Elijah when you got him out the cave? God said, I whisper because I'm close.
That is so fire.
I remember the night back in late November. I was out in the cold, I was alone praying for answers. The storm was loud, but it couldn't tell me nothing. The fire was wild, but it just left me struggling. You're moving the stillness, you're moving the stillness. Closing the distance, now I can feel it. Now I can feel ya.
Ooh,
your voice isn't hidden, your voice isn't hidden. I just gotta listen, listen.
I hear you whisper.
Regret not taking a step toward my purpose. I'm waking up, taking a new perspective. The night was long until I got the message. You're moving the stillness, you're moving the stillness. Closing the
can feel ya. Ooh, why? Your voice isn't hidden, your voice isn't hidden. I just gotta listen, listen. I hear you whisper.
I want to play that one.
Just because
it was the perfect.
No, no, it's perfect. I text you. I was like, that yes. song is the song yeah. for me.
I would have never put an idea of depression or loneliness and associate it with Marty. This seemingly happy-go-lucky, fun-loving, creative, who has these clever tongue-in-cheek lines and rap songs, but he's really going through something. So I think my eyes were opened not to underestimate the reality of people's lives and the good that having more real conversations can do. The last song, it is a song called Famous For.
Woo!
It's my, this is a good
What's the name of it?
Famous For.
There is no fear. Cause I believe there is no doubt. Cause I have seen your faithfulness, my fortress, over and over. I have a hope found in your name. I have a strength.
Grace,
your faithfulness, my fortress, over and over. Make way through the waters, walk me through the fire. Do what you are famous for, what you are famous for. Shut the in you, God, I believe in you. Release your love inside of me. Unleash your power for all to see. Spirit, come and fall on us over and over.
This is a song about audacious faith. This song, Famous For.
I love it so much. Yeah. I love it so much.
What does audacious faith look like, and what is the big thing that you're asking God to do? Like, if you're saying you are famous for your faithfulness, this is what I want to see in this generation and in the world today. What is that prayer?
Torm, right before we hit on that, right when you said the name of the title, you said Famous For. So I didn't know where you were going to take that with your song. But the first thing that hit me was, what are you famous for? you know, mm-hmm. meaning like you or all of us, what are you famous for? And I'm grateful to sit in a room with all of you guys that you're most famous for proclaiming and loving Jesus.
Yeah.
That is really cool, because when that's what you're famous for, it means that you stood for it at some time in your life against opposition.
Wow.
And one of Winston Churchill's famous quotes is, if you have enemies good, it means you stood for something at least once in your life.
Wow.
You know, and I'm sure every one of you have had that in your life, you know,
really,
and that enemy could be doubt, or it could be insignificance, or it could be meaning, or it could be worry about, I missed out on something else, you know,
yeah.
But that song was just so encouraging in those ways, and you guys have been so encouraging in those ways.
One of the things I'm thinking of when hearing that song is that the only way people get to hear the story of how God was famous in our lives is if we tell from the middle. Is if we tell while we're still waiting. Mm-hmm. You know, like, I mean, I think in a lot of your lives.
What do you mean tell from the middle?
Like, can I use your life as an example, Rich? I mean, when they were trying to have a family, you invited all of us in. I mean, we've been friends for a day. But I remember that when they did get pregnant, I went, look at what God did.
Yeah.
Because you Rich and Dawn Shree shared from the middle.
Oh, wow.
You know, like, I want to get married. I'll share from the middle.
Yeah.
That I want God to show up for me like that.
Yeah.
So I can tell the truth of what it feels like to hope right here.
That's good. Yeah.
And then when it happens, we can go,
it's beautiful.
He parted the waters, right?
Yes.
So we
so we
just have to tell what we really know of him before we see him do the thing we know he's going to do.
But we're always so scared, I feel like, when you're in
the
middle.
Totally.
Annie F. Downs started to share about how the power of our story is when we start telling it from the middle. Just a great insight into everyday life. The power of our story is when we tell it from the middle. It was a collective, like, wow.
I think that tension, right, is like that both, we have to have bold faith that we believe that our God, he can move mountains, that he does part Red Seas, that he does close mouths of lions. I love that thought, you know, if God answered all your prayers, would it change your life or would it change the world?
Yes.
Whoa.
And you want to pray a little bit bigger, and I want to dream for something more. And so when you ask the question, like, what are you boldly believing for? There's a lot of dreams I feel like God's given me, and I want to be a church builder. I want to see the name of Jesus continue to be raised up in our nation and around the world.
Yes, sir.
Yet on the flip side of this whole thing of faith, as you read Hebrews, you know, as you get to Hebrews 11 and 12, which is like the hall of faith, it testifies about these men and women that did great things, but then there's all these other people that, like, no, they were sawed in two, and they, we don't know their name, and the scripture says, and the world was not worthy of them.
Yeah.
And so I think when it comes to the end of this thing about bold faith, audacious faith, bold faith is not about success. Bold faith is about just literally being faithful to what God's called you to do, step by step, moment by moment. And so at the end of my life, you know, it's like, I'm praying I lived out faithful. I want to speak big. I want to declare big.
Yes.
I love that. That's going to be my new 6:15 a.m. Sunday morning workout music, because we do a full worship service before church. But like that's what I want to go into with Sundays. But if God doesn't do it,
right.
If God doesn't do the things I'm asking for, you know, Shadrach, we know he can, we know that he will, but even if he don't, bro, and that's the whole idea that we have to, I think, process more and more, which is you're saying, like, keep documenting our stories about God's faithfulness, because he is parting water still, and he is still shutting mouths of lions.
Yeah, that's such a good point. I also would love to add that it's about being willing to step out and say, you know what, it's okay to be different. Mm-hmm. It's okay to be unique.
Mm-hmm.
It's okay to believe in a big God, because we also, we're called, we're co-heirs with God, but we're co-laborers with him, you know? And we think that we have to do all this, but when we step out, God says, watch me come through and do all this.
Right.
And that changes everything when we just say, okay, I'm going to have big faith, but that doesn't mean that I have to do it all. God gets to come in and do everything. And then he also gets the glory out of it.
Yeah, sometimes we're in our own way.
And in God's way.
Yeah. He don't need you, but it's like, it's awesome that he wants to use us. I think that's kind of cool too.
I think what's encouraging too about that song, you know, it's like in a fast way running through so many of the miracles in the Bible. But then it just encourages me, God can use you.
Yeah.
Because I know that I'm a screw up and I'm a mess up and I'm flawed and I have bad thoughts, bad words, bad actions, all of these things. But God says, I can still use you. And then when we understand the weight of our depravity, we understand how far God has taken us and then how far he will take you, because look at what he did for the heroes in the Bible. And you just brought up Hebrews 11 and 12. And I love Hebrews 11 and 12, the hall of faith. But then we get into Hebrews 12 talking about run with endurance. Well, anyone who's ever trained in their entire life, they know if you mention endurance, it means that it's going to suck. Yeah. Anyone who's ever trained, if you've ever trained in anything in your life, and you have to do something endurance-wise, it is going to suck. If you have to do a push-up's endurance, if you have to run a marathon, that's endurance. If you have to do anything that means endurance, it means hard. But we have to run with endurance, the race that is set before us. And then in verse 2, fixing our eyes on Jesus, that's the true author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despite the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the Father. It's literally telling us what we're supposed to do. Fixing our eyes on Jesus. Sure. So instead of looking here and looking there and seeing the waves and seeing everything else around us, it's giving us, it's saying, do something. Mm-hmm. Literally fix your eyes on Jesus. When you fix it, you focus. Good. You know, and anytime you've trained, you've trained yourself to be so focused on something. And as believers, we're supposed to be so focused on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross. What was the joy set before Jesus? It was you, and it was me. It wasn't the pain of the cross. It was the healing of the cross. Mm-hmm. The joy set before him is us being made right with the God of this universe. Yeah. And so for the joy set before him, he went to the cross. Because the joy set before him, he despised the shame. And then when it was done, then he sat down at the right hand of the Father. But you know what? That's an example and a picture to us and to me. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Beautiful. For all these things that you've got to go through, and then when your time's done, you get to sit down, but it's not done yet. Jesus had a mission, he fulfilled it, and then he sat down. You have a mission, I have a mission. We gotta fulfill that mission, and then we get to sit down. Yeah. And when we understand our mission, then we know how far we have to go till it's complete.
Right.
Yeah, that's good.
So good.
Wow. That was amazing.
I think that's how we carry our faith into life and into culture. And I just wanna say thank you to all you guys once again for sitting down around these songs, around these ideas. Man. I have so much respect for every one of you, what you've contributed to this conversation. If it does for anyone else what this conversation just did for me, then it's gonna matter. It's gonna mean something. Thank you guys for being
Thank
here.
You for having us.
And wrap. I think the tone was what I hoped for, but didn't know that we would get to. There was a vulnerability and a transparency in everyone. What I thought was really cool was that everyone was unique. There is someone for everyone to connect with. So I hope that there's something awakened in your heart, that you realize you have a voice. Insert yourself into a community. Get some people that call out the best in you. Get people that believe in you and that build you up, because that's gonna be the way that you really walk into the ultimate purpose for your life. Thank you guys so much for joining the conversation. This is Faith, Life, and Culture.